بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، صلى الله وسلم وبارك على عبده ورسوله نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين، ما بعد. So the topic is apparently the hearts. Even though I thought there was something else, so it's no problem though.
Switch it up, start.
No, because subhanAllah, it sounds like something that I would suggest. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran about the heart of the human being. Allah says in the Quran, يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. The day of judgment is going to be a day where nothing is going to benefit someone. No one's going to benefit from لا ينفعُ مالٌ, from the wealth. You're not going to benefit from wealth. وَلَا بَنُونَ, or your children, on that day, يوم القيامة. إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ, except for the one who comes with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala yawm al-qiyamah, on that day, with a heart that is clean. Scholars of tafsir, they mention the different diseases of the heart, and the greatest one being shirk of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, someone who has in their heart other than Allah, worshipping other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so the scholars of Islam, based on this, in this topic of rectifying the heart, they wrote a whole topic, or they wrote a subject, they made a subject that's known in Islam as tazkiyatun nafs, purifying the souls. And the subject in reality is a subject that has been sometimes neglected by a lot of Muslims. The subject of purifying the heart from the things that will deviate it, and beautifying it with those things that will bring it closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So based on this, we see that, and me, I don't like doing lectures where you just listen, to be honest. I like teaching. As the brothers probably know, I like to teach. So I'm going to structure everything I do in a way of teaching. And today, inshallah ta'ala, the rectifying of the hearts, we're going to go to two things, inshallah ta'ala. Number one, we know that rectifying the heart, tazkiyatun nafs, is based on two things. Number one is based on at-takhliya, is cleaning the heart from the diseases that make it impure. Cleaning the heart from the diseases that make it impure. And number two is beautifying it with those good deeds of the heart that bring you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Shaykh Abd al-Rahman ibn Nasir al-Sa'di, one of the scholars of Unayza, who died in the past century, he wrote a poem called As-Sayru ila Allahi wa Dari al-Akhirah. He wrote a poem called The Journey to Allah and the Journey to the House of the Akhirah, in which he spoke about the different stages of that a person must meet on their journey to Allah Azza wa Jal, meaning the different actions of the heart that they must do in order to get to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For you to get to Allah yawm al-qiyamah, yawm la yanfa'u malun wala banun, the day when the heart, the wealth is not going to benefit you, nor your children, then are they going to benefit you. Except for who? Except for the one who comes to Allah. So that journey to Allah, بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. You come to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with a clean heart. He says in this book, when he talks about this journey that we make to Allah, he says the first line, is a small lines of poetry where he says, سَعِدَ الَّذِينَ تَجَنَّبُوا سُبُلَ الرَّدَى وَتَيَمَّمُوا بِمَنَازِلِ الْإِيمَانِ. Those people, they are happy. The happy people are the ones who تَجَنَّبُوا سُبُلَ الرَّدَى. They go away from the paths of destruction, and they take the paths of the pleasure and iman in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these are the two things: staying away from the destruction and taking a path to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in reality, this topic, it needs a lot of lectures, like it needs a lot of details with regards to each one of these things that we need to stay away from, we need to beautify ourselves from. But to understand the dangers of some of these things, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us about one disease of the heart. This is one disease that I'm going to mention now. We'll mention a few inshallah ta'ala, but look at the first one. So we're looking at what? The things that we need to stay away from, and the things that we need to beautify ourselves with. The first thing, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gives us an example, and he says, إِنَّ الرَّجُلَ لَيَعْمَلُ بِعَمَلِ أَهْلِ الْجَنَّةِ. A man will be doing the deeds of the people of Jannah. حَتَّى مَا يَكُونُ بَيْنَهُ وَبَيْنَهَا إِلَّا ذِرَاعٌ. Until there is nothing between him and Jannah except for an elbow's length, dhira', up to this much. And then in another narration, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Fima yabdu lin-nas," according to the people, how they see. So he's doing the actions of the people of Jannah his whole life. Until حتى ما يكون بينه وبينها إلا ذراع. There's nothing between him and Jannah except for an elbow's length. It's about to enter into Jannah. So Allah says, فَيَسْبِقُ عَلَيْهِ الْكِتَابِ What was written against him, it overtakes him. فَيَعْمَلُ بِعَمَلِ أَهْلِ النَّارِ He starts to do the actions of the people of the hellfire. فَيَدْخُلَهَا and he'll enter into the hellfire. Why? Why this man, his whole life, he was doing good deeds. He was getting closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But in the last moment, Allah deviated his heart. And he entered into the hellfire because of it. And Allah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the dua that he used to make the most was what? Allahumma ya muqallib al-qulub, thabbit qalbi ala deenik. Oh Allah, the one who changes the hearts, keep my heart firm upon your religion. And Allah is not oppressive to anyone. Someone's doing 80 years of good deeds. It's not fathomable that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his last year, his last 6 months, Allah will deviate his heart and he'll leave Islam or he'll leave of doing those things for no reason. Rather, Allah is the most just, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most just and everything he does with the wisdom. And so we look into this hadith. Why did Allah deviate this person's heart? Why do we look into this? So we can stay away from it. We see in another narration, in the narration of Imam Ahmad, as I mentioned to you guys already, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, يَعْمَلُ بِعَمَلِ أَهْلِ الْجَنَّةِ فِي مَا يَرَاهُ النَّاسِ According to how the people see. Meaning all of those good deeds, he was doing it showing off. All of his life, he was doing good deeds showing off to the creation. Al-Riya is the first disease that I want you guys to write down. Al-Riya, showing off, is the disease that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because of that, he deviated that man's heart. And so at the end of his life, when he was about to enter into a Jannah, La ilaha illallah was taken away from him. And Sufyan ibn Uyayn used to be traveling and he would be crying a lot during his travels. He was one of the scholars of Islam from the early generations, from the students of the companions, from the people of Mecca he was. Sufyan ibn Uyayn would be traveling and he would be crying a lot and his companions during his travel would see him crying. And they would say to him, Are you crying because of your sins? Sufyan would say, He would pick up a piece of bark from the tree and he would throw it and say, my sins are lighter than this. Yani Allah can forgive the sins. That's not what I'm crying over. But what I'm crying over is that I fear that La ilaha illallah will be taken away from me in the last moment. Why is La ilaha illallah taken away from someone in the last moment? This is one of the reasons. Al-Riya. He was showing off his whole life. What's Al-Riya? Al-Riya is for you to do a good deed. So the people see it and they praise you for it. That's riya. Notice this definition, huh? Write it down if you want. Or memorize it. If you're not writing, you probably memorize it, mashallah. You guys have good memories. You do a good deed so that people see it in order for them to praise you. طيب, you do a good deed for people to see it. Is it always riya then? Is it always showing off? If you do a good deed and you want people to see it, is that always showing off? No, why? What, give me a situation where it's not showing off then. You want to teach your family. You come back home. You know the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is that you come to the masjid, you pray your fard salah. Then, if you're not going to stay in the masjid and you're going home, go pray your sunnah salah at home. That's the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Why? So you can teach your family. So you want them to see you. Like, why do you want them to see you? To praise you. No one really cares. Most of us don't really care if your children or wife praises you, right? That's not really affecting riya. So the Prophet ﷺ says, go and do it in your house because it's closer to sincerity. And it's because you teach the people. You teach your family. So when is it riya? It's riya when you want the people to praise you for this good deed. Look at this person, look how he prays, mashallah. The Prophet ﷺ told us in a hadith narrated by Imam Ahmad in his Musnad, Prophet ﷺ said, أَخْوَفُ مَا أَخَافُ عَلَيْكُمْ الشِّرْكُ الْخَفِي The thing that I fear most for you is hidden shirk. يَقُومُ الرَّجُلُ A man stands up. فيزين صلاته لما يراه من نظر رجل. He beautifies his salah because he can see people looking at him. If it was by himself, he wouldn't be praying like that. But because people are looking at him, he wants the people to praise him, and so he beautifies his salah. طيب, if someone is shy to do a sin, or he's shy to pray fast, so he prays normally. Is that riya? No, that's not riya. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us that be shy of doing sins like you would be shy if the most honorable people in your community was looking at you as you're doing it. So it's okay. It's It's understandable that someone, he'll be shy to be doing a sin in front of people. That's not riya, that's not showing off. Some people will take that wrongly and that, I don't care if the people see me. It's showing off. I'm not, my sins are between me and Allah. I don't care. Nah, be shy to do sins, of course. طيب. So riya is for the people, for you to do a good deed. For the people to see you and they praise you for it. And it's the riya, what's the result of it? Number one, habit lil'amal. Your good deeds are null and void. The good deed you done there, null and void. Allah doesn't accept it. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Allah said in the hadith ilahi, يعني, from Allah said, أنا أغنى الشركاء يعني الشرك. I am the most rich of the people from shirk. I don't need shirk. من عمل عملا أشرك فيه معي غيري تركته وشركه. Whoever does a good deed, he in his heart is me, and other than me, I leave him and his shirk. Do it, it's all for that person. Meaning, you can't do a good deed for the sake of Allah, but then whilst you're doing the good deed, you look at the people and you're doing it for them as well. That's riya as well. Yes, he's doing it for Allah, but he's doing it for other than Allah as well. Allah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Allah said, تركته وشركة. I leave it and I leave his shirk as well. Number one, حابط للعمل. It, what does it do? Nullifies the good deed. It nullifies the good deed. Number two, the second result of riya is what we mentioned. It is a cause for a person to deviate from the sake of Allah, from the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's a cause for a person to deviate from the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And number three, it's a cause for the punishment in the akhirah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us in a hadith narrated by At-Tabarani in his in his tafsir. In the ayah when Allah says, Man kana yuridu al-hayata al-dunya wa zinataha نوفي إليهم أعمالهم فيها وهم فيها لا يبخسون. Whoever wants the life of this dunya, your intention with your good deeds is the dunya. من كان يريد الحياة الدنيا وزينتها and its beautification, cars and money. من كان يريد الحياة الدنيا وزينتها. What's the result of that? You want that? نوفي إليهم أعمالهم فيها. We're gonna give them the good deeds. We're gonna give them their deeds that they done in the dunya. You were doing something for the dunya. You're gonna get the reward in the dunya. وهم فيها لا يبخسون. Allah is not going to decrease you in any way. You wanted the dunya, you're going to get the dunya. What does Allah say? أولئك الذين ليس لهم في الآخرة إلا النار. But on the day of judgment in the آخرة, they have nothing but the fire. ليس لهم في الآخرة إلا النار. وحبط ما صنعوا فيها. And everything that they done do is what? They done is حبطوا. وحبط ما صنعوا فيها. It's null and void. وباطل ما كانوا يعملون. And all of their good deeds are false, null and void, and not accepted. At-Tabari mentioned a hadith about this ayah that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, and it has a long story which I don't want to mention, which is a man came to Abu Huraira and he said to Abu Huraira, tell me a hadith that you heard from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Abu Huraira fainted. He fainted. Then he woke up and he said, tell me a hadith that you heard from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Abu Huraira fainted. Third time same, Abu Huraira fainted and he got up. And he said to him, I heard the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying, أول من تسعر بهم النار. The first people that the hellfire will be ignited with. The first people the hellfire will be ignited with are who? Number one, an alim, a person of knowledge. Number two, a mujahid, someone fighting for the sake of Allah. Number three, a person used to give charity. It will be said to the alim, to the qari, he was a qari, he used to recite the Quran. يقال له, it will be said to him, ما عملت, what did you do? On the day of judgment. فيقول, he would say, Ya Allah, قرأت فيك القرآن. I recited the Quran for your sake, O Allah. And I taught the people the Quran. For your sake. Allah will say to him, كذبت, you have lied. The angels will say, you have lied. إنما قرأت ليقال قارئ. The only reason you recited the Quran was so the people say you're a قارئ. The only reason why you started to learn knowledge was so the people, they big you up as an alim, as a scholar, as a speaker. والعياذ بالله. And it will be said to him, enter into the hellfire face first. And he will be dragged face first into the hellfire. And the second person, the generous person, used to give, he said, I gave for your sake, oh Allah. You have lied, you gave, so the people say this man's generous. And the people said it. وَقَدْ قِيلِ, it was said. يعني that was the reward, remember the ayah, right? نُوَفِّي إِلَيْهِمْ أَعْمَالَهُمْ فِيهَا. What you wanted in the dunya is going to be given to you. You wanted the people to praise you, the people praised you. Lakin on the day of judgment, it will be said to him, go take him first, face first in the hellfire. Then the person who fought for the sake of Allah. Look how dangerous the riya' showing off is. He fought for the sake of Allah until he died. And it will be said, why did you do that? I fought for your sake of Allah. It will be said, no, you fought. So the people say so-and-so is brave. And the people said you were brave and you died as a hero for the country or forever. You died as that. Take him first, face first into the hellfire. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said at the end of the hadith, these are the first three people that the hellfire will be ignited with. Dangers of al-riya. Imagine a person doing all these good deeds, speaking in front of people, learning the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, learning the Quran, and all of it null and void. Why? Because he didn't clean his heart from what? From showing off. What branches of showing off is what? As-sum'ah. Sum'ah is a type of showing off. As-sum'ah is the second one, which is, as-sum'ah is for the people, for you to do a good deed, so the people hear about it and praise you for it. Yeah, and you stand up, you pray at night. In the morning you come and you say, brothers, yeah man, subhanAllah, I'm tired. Why are you tired? I was just praying at night. Huh? He wants the people to praise him for it. Oh, I just came from that class and then I have to go to this class. And I was doing this and I was doing that. I came from Umrah, Tawaf. Why? So the people say, I'm Hajj. All of these things. Sum'ah for the people to talk when he talks about it. It's the brother of Riyah. Same thing. Same thing. It nullifies the deed as well. Just like Riyah nullifies the deed, As-sum'ah also nullified the deed. And I want to speak about these things that we need to clean our heart first, at the beginning first. If we get time, we'll speak about the things we need to beautify our heart with as well. But inshallah, these things are important because At-takhliya comes before tahliya. Clearing out the dirt comes before beautifying, right? So we need to understand these deeds that can affect any single one, any one of us. Imagine the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in hadith narrated by Muslim in al-Sahih, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that al-riya' showing off is akhfa min damim al-naml. Is more hidden than the footsteps of an ant on a dark ala sakhratin sawda on a black boulder on a dark night. Imagine an ant, the footsteps that it has on a rock on a dark night. Can you even see the footsteps? It's dark and it's an ant and it's on a black rock. Would you be able to see it? Al-riya is more hidden than that. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was asked him, "Fama al-makhraj ya Rasulullah?" What's the way out in that case, O Messenger of Allah? Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Say, make the du'a. Allahumma inni a'udhu bika an ushrika bika shay'an wa ana a'lam wa astaghfiruka lima la a'lam." O Allah, I seek refuge, O Allah, from me doing shirk with you whilst I know. And I ask you, O Allah, to forgive me for what I didn't know. Make this du'a. Allahumma inni a'udhu bika من أن اللهم إني أعوذ بك من أن أشرك بك شيئا وأنا أعلم وأستغفرك لما لا أعلم. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم taught us that dua to stay away from الرياء. From amongst the dangers as well. So we spoke about الرياء, السمعة. السمعة is the same as الرياء. Whatever we said about الرياء, we say about السمعة. Number three, which is also dangerous upon the Muslims, and it has evil results, and I'll mention the results of it as well, inshallah ta'ala, is كبر. كبر is arrogance. It's a disease of the heart. Kibr is arrogance, the disease of the heart. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, لا يدخل الجنة من كان في قلبه مثقال ذرة من كبر. The person will not enter into Jannah whoever has the ant's weight of kibr, arrogance in his heart. What's the definition of arrogance? He mentions in the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, it is بطر الحق وغمط الناس. For you to deny the truth when it comes to you and belittle other people. For you to deny the truth and belittle other people. And notice how these two are connected, right? Someone will bring you the truth, but he's a little child. Or maybe it's someone who you saw growing up. You probably changed their nappies, and now, subhanAllah, they're 20 and 25 and 30, and they're bringing you something that's from the deen of Allah. But I changed this person's nappies, I can't accept it from him. That's what kibr is. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, he will not enter into Jannah, the person who has an ant's weight of kibr in his heart. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us another hadith, kafa bil mar'i ithman an yahqira. Is enough for a person to do a sin? Enough of a sin is an yahqira akhahu al-muslim, for the Muslim to belittle his Muslim brother. It's enough of a sin. What's the evil result of al-kibr? What's the evil result of al-kibr? Allah mentions it in the Quran. Allah says, sa'asrifu an ayati alladhina yatakabbaruna fil ardi bighayri al-haq. I'm going to turn away my ayat from those people who are arrogant on the earth without any right. So the result of it is what? The deen of Allah, the ayat of Allah in the Quran, they're not gonna affect you. They're not gonna affect you. You will hear the ayat of Allah and it's as if you're not hearing anything. Wal'iyadu billah. A hard heart. Hard heart. And sometimes, subhanAllah, this can be coated in the coat and covering of the deen. Someone's a person of religion, he's got a beard. And he's practicing, he's in the masjid. Lakin he's belittling other Muslims. Why? Because maybe they're not as good as you. Maybe they don't look as good as you. Maybe outwardly, your appearance, the, what you do outwardly is more than what they do. Lakin subhanAllah, who knows what manzila, what position he has in front of Allah and what position you have in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so the scholars, they say that this ayah, even though it says, I'm going to turn away from my ayat those people who are arrogant. They're not going to understand the ayat of Allah. Some of the scholars, they questioned and they said, well, in that case, why are some people arrogant, but they memorize the whole Quran? But Allah said, I'm going to turn away the ayat from them. What does that mean? Sufyan ibn Uyayna, the same man that I spoke about before, Sufyan ibn Uyayna, he said, the meaning of this ayah is, أحرمهم فهم القرآن. أحرمهم فهم القرآن. I'm going to prevent them from understanding the Quran. They'll be able to read it. They may even be able to read it in a beautiful voice, but they won't be able to benefit from it. They're not going to be able to understand the Quran. And the dangers of kibr. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us another incident of someone who has arrogance. A man from Banu Israel used to come out and see a sinner outside, and it was his brother, it was his friend. But he would be sinning constantly. And every time he would go to him, he would go past him, he would say to him, Intahi, stop. And the man would say, Khallini wa Rabbi, leave me and my Lord. Leave me between me and my Lord. Until one day, he said to him, stop doing what you're doing. And he saw him doing a huge sin. He said, stop doing what you're doing. لا يغفر الله لك. Allah's not going to forgive you out of arrogance. Because he was a worshipper. He would go out to the masjid. And this man would be out there in on the street doing nothing. And he was a worshipper. And he said, out of arrogance, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not going to forgive you. And so Allah Azza wa Jal said, Abu Huraira narrates from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that Allah Azza wa Jal said, من ذا الذي يتألى علي ألا أغفر لفلان. Who is this person so and so that's making an oath by Allah, swearing by Allah that I'm not going to forgive so and so? Who is that? قد غفرت لفلان وأحبطت عملك. I have forgiven so and so, that sinner. I've forgiven him. And I've made all of your good deeds null and void because of the arrogance that he had in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This arrogance can creep into anyone's heart. And the way to cure it, and riya, the way to cure it is for a person to remember their sins. Constantly remember your sins. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us, kullu ibn Adam khata. Every son of Adam is someone who's consistently sinning again and again and again. وَخَيْرُ الْخَطَّائِينَ التَّوَّابُونَ. The best of those who sin are those who repent. So every son of Adam, they do sins. Allah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us in hadith, Ya ibn Adam, O son of Adam, إِنَّكُمْ تُخْطِئُونَ بِاللَّيْلِ وَالنَّهَارِ. You do sins, commit sins during the day and during the night. وَأَنَا أَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا. And I forgive all sins. فَاسْتَغْفِرُونِي. Ask me to forgive you. أَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ. I will forgive you. Remember, as a son, you're a son of Adam who does sins day and night. Who are you to be arrogant against another human being? Who knows who's been accepted in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What good deeds have been accepted in front of Allah? The people who are not arrogant, the people of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the real ones who know Allah azza wa jal, they don't have arrogance in their heart. Allah mentions about them in the Quran. Allah says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ هُمْ مِنْ خَشَّةِ رَبِّهِمْ مُشْفِقُونَ. They are people, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ هُمْ مِنْ خَشَّةِ رَبِّهِمْ مُشْفِقُونَ. They fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ بِرَبِّهِمْ لَا يُشْرِكُونَ. وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ بِآيَاتِ رَبِّهِمْ يُؤْمِنُونَ. They don't do shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They don't worship other than Allah. They believe in the ayat of Allah. وَالَّذِينَ يُؤْتُونَ مَا آتَوْا. And they give charity for the sake of Allah. But what's their hal? What's their situation whilst they're doing all of these good deeds? Are they arrogant on the earth walking like that? لا. Allah says, وَالَّذِينَ يُؤْتُونَ مَا آتَوْا وَقُلُوبُهُمْ وَجِلَةٌ. Their hearts are trembling. فَقُلُوبُهُمْ وَجِلَةٌ أَنَّهُمْ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ رَاجِعُونَ. Their hearts are trembling out of fear because they know that they're going back to Allah. Our mother Aisha radiallahu anha, the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said, Ya Rasulullah, O Messenger of Allah, are these the people who commit zina and steal and kill? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, no. They do these good deeds, but their hearts are trembling. Why? Because they're scared that maybe Allah didn't accept it from them. All of the good deeds that they're doing, they're scared, did Allah accept it from me? Have I done it in a good way? Have I done it properly? That's what Allah says in the Quran, the believers, what should we do? فَإِذَا فَرَغْتَ. When you finish one good deed, فَانْصَبْ. Do another good deed. You don't know if Allah accepted it from you. Do another one. Obviously, there's an extreme to this, which is what? Some people say, Allah, I don't know if Allah is going to accept it from me, so they're not going to do any more good deeds. لا, that's an extreme. والله, but there's another extreme as well. He does a good deed. He thinks he's arrogant. He thinks he's the best, and خلاص, I'm going to Jannah. لا, it's another extreme. But the middle path is what? To do those good deeds and keep doing it. Don't stop. لكن remember that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who knows who has a position in front of Allah. We don't know where we are in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it's good for a person to have these characteristics. يُؤْتُونَ مَا أَتُوا وَقُلُوبُهُمْ وَجِلَةٌ أَنَّهُمْ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ رَاجِعُونَ. They know that they're going back to Allah. So their heart's trembling. This is one of the cures to arrogance. As for the cure to riyah, to showing off, then Allah mentions it in one ayah in the Quran. One ayah in the Quran, it mentions, in this ayah they say, تَنْزِعُ جُذُورَ الشِّرْكِ وَتَنْزِعُ جُذُورَ الرِّيَاءِ مِنَ الْقَلْبِ. It removes the roots of showing off from the heart. And this is the last ayah in Surah Al-Kahf. Allah says in the Quran, last ayah in Surah Al-Kahf, قُلْ إِنَّمَا أَنَا بَشَرٌ مِثْلُكُمْ. Say to them, say to the human beings, إِنَّمَا أَنَا بَشَرٌ مِثْلُكُمْ. I am only a human being just like you. I am a human being just like you. What do you benefit from that when it comes to riyah? Remember that person that you're showing off to, the person that you want to praise you, the person that you're beautifying your prayer for, is a human being just like you. He goes to the toilet just like you go to the toilet. He does sin just like you do sins. A human being, لا ينفع ولا يضر. He can't benefit you and he can't harm you. Only Allah is the one that can benefit you, and only Allah is the one who can harm you. So say to them, إنما أنا بشر مثلكم. I'm a human being just like you. Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, Rasulullah, he is commanded to say, I'm only a human being just like you. إنما أنا بشر مثلكم. يوحى إلي, it's been revealed to me, أنما إلهكم إله واحد. That the one that you should worship is only one إله, one deity that you should worship. That shows what? الرياء is a type of shirk. So don't put other gods in your heart that you worship by doing riya for them, showing off, because it's as if you're taking them as aliha besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah says, يُوحَى إِلَيَّ أَنَّمَا إِلَهُكُمْ إِلَهٌ وَاحِدٌ فَمَنْ كَانَ يَرُجُوا لِقَاءَ رَبِّهِ. Whoever hopes in the meeting of his Lord. If you hope in the meeting of Allah, you want to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with a reward. فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا. Let him do deeds which are salih. What's a good deed which is salih? What's a salih, a good deed? Two things. What are they? For any good deed to be accepted, what has to be in there? It has to be sincerely for the sake of Allah. And that rejects what? Showing off. Any good deed that you want to do, it has to be sincerely for the sake of Allah. For it to be called amalun salih, a good deed, it has to be sincerely for the sake of Allah. If any other thing other than Allah comes into your heart with that good, for that good deed, it's null and void. You haven't done it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not salih. إِنَّمَا أَنَا بَشْرٌ فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا. And the second thing about action for it to be good deed is what? It has to be in a conforming with the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You might be sincere. There might be a man who's sincere, but he's doing a bid'ah. He's doing an innovation. He's worshipping Allah in a way that Allah never legislated. Instead of worshipping Allah by praying the five daily prayers, praying nawafil salawat, or fasting, or doing hajj or umrah, he's sitting down and just saying, oh, Allah, Allah, Allah. That's not a good deed. Allah did not tell you to do that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught us what are good deeds. What are these deeds that are unconforming? How do we know? The sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَنْ عَمِلَ عَمَلًا لَيْسَ عَلَيْهِ أَمْرُنَا فَهُوَ رَدْ. Whoever does a deed that we haven't commanded you to do, فَهُوَ رَدْ, is rejected. So again, the point is, number one is only إِنَّمَا أَنَا بَشَرٌ مِثْلُكُمْ. This ayah, it removes riyah from the heart. Everyone else is just a human being just like you. يُوحَى إِلَيَّ أَنَّمَا إِلَهُكُمْ إِلَهٌ وَاحِدٌ. It's revealed to me that your Lord, your Ilah, the one that you should worship, is only one Ilah. فَمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُو لِقَاءَ رَبِّهِ. Whoever hopes in the meeting of his Lord, فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا. Let him do deeds which are salih. Which are those two things? Sincere for the sake of Allah. And then he says, وَلَا يُشْرِكْ بِعِبَادَةِ رَبِّهِ أَحَدًا. And you do not do shirk in the worship of your Lord. الرياء is a type of shirk. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam called it shirk al-khafi. Shirk al-khafi, hidden shirk. Right? Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us how hidden it is. فالرياء, السمعة, الكبر. Number four I'll mention as well, which is common as well amongst us. These are the things that we need to clean from our hearts. العجب. العجب. Which is for a person to be amazed by their good deeds. For a person to be amazed by their good deeds. What you mean by that? Is a type of arrogance. It's a sub-branch of, just like sum'ah is a type of riyah, al-ujb is a type of kibr, of a type of arrogance, which is that someone, he does a good deed, he does a good deed, and he thinks after he does that good deed that he's the best. He thinks good of himself, that I am the one who is able to do all of these good deeds. And the cure for that, and the hadith for that is the hadith of that man, right? He thought he was good, and he said to that, I said, who's going to forgive this person? How is Allah going to forgive such a person? Oh, Allah will never forgive you. And so what did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say? Allah said in the hadith, man kanda alladhi yata'alla alayya alla aghfira li fulan. Who is this person who's making an oath that I'm not going to forgive so and so? قَدْ غَفَرْتُ لِفُلَانَ I've forgiven so-and-so وَأَحْبَطُ عَمَلَكَ and I've made a good deed null and void. العجب. You do a good deed and you're amazed by it. You think that I'm the best because of this. It's called العجب. And the result of that again is that it is a reason for your deed to be null and void. It's a reason for the good deed to also be null and void. See, these are some of the dangers of the heart that a person, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when the Shaykh Abdurrahman Nasir al-Sa'idi, when he says, سُعِدَ الَّذِينَ تَجَنَّبُوا سُبُلَ الرَّدَى وَتَيَمَّمُوا بِمَنَازِلِ الرِّضْوَانِ. Those people, they are happy, those people who take the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they stay away from those evils. وَتَيَمَّمُوا بِمَنَازِلِ الرِّضْوَانِ, and they cover themselves, or they take the paths of the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what are some of the, we mentioned four, like in, I highly advise brothers, because of the time, we're not going to be able to mention all of them, but I highly advise brothers and sisters, look into this topic in the way that Ahlul Sunnah spoke about it, the people of Sunnah, because there were some people who deviated in this topic, and they delved into it with ignorance. They delved into it with ignorance. What do I mean by that? Some people, they didn't understand these topics the way that it should be understood. So they took some of the things that you beautify your heart with, which we're going to mention some of them inshallah, they took some of them and they understood it in a wrong way. For example, the beautification of our heart with the deed of ar-raja, hoping in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now let's say someone's working on removing these evils from his heart. He tries to now beautify himself with certain good deeds of his heart that's going to get him closer to Allah. Like what? Like ar-raja, hoping in Allah Azza wa Jal. And Allah praises those people who hope in Him. Allah says in the Quran, إِنَّهُمْ كَانُوا about the family of Zakariya. When Zakariya made dua to Allah, he says, رَبِّ لَا تَذَرْنِي فَرْدًا وَأَنْتَ خَيْرُ الْوَارِثِينَ. Oh my Lord, do not leave me alone without a child. يعني. وَأَنْتَ خَيْرُ الْوَارِثِينَ. Meaning, so Allah gave him, Allah says, فَاسْتَجَبْنَا لَهُ. We responded to Zakariya. وَأَصْلَحْنَا لَهُ وَوَهَبْنَا لَهُ يَحْيَى. We gave him a son because he made dua for a son, right? So Allah gave him a son. وَوَهَبْنَا لَهُ يَحْيَى وَأَصْلَحْنَا لَهُ زَوْجًا. And we rectified his wife for him. How does Allah mention the family of Zakariya? He says, إِنَّهُمْ كَانُوا يَدْعُونَنَا رَغَبًا وَرَهَبًا وَكَانُوا لَنَا خَاشِعِينَ. They used to call upon us. They used to make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala رَغَبًا, out of hope in Allah. وَرَهَبًا, and out of fear of Allah. وَكَانُوا لَنَا خَاشِعِينَ. And they had khushu, they had fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. يعني رغباً, Allah praises them, why? Because they had hope in Allah. What's this hope that we mean? It's for someone to understand that with Allah is the ultimate goal. The reward that Allah will give, the reward that we're looking for, ultimately is only with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we know that Allah is the most generous of the generous. Allah is the most generous of the generous. So when we make our salah, we hope that Allah will accept it from us. We hope that Allah will accept it from us. We hope that when we fast, that Allah will accept it from us. When we make dua, we hope that Allah will accept it from us. This is the act of al-raja. How was it misunderstood? Al-raja was misunderstood by some people based on ignorance. They would hope in Allah so much that they would say, Allah is going to enter us into Jannah as long as we just say, La ilaha illallah, we're Muslims, that's it. We don't have to do good deeds, we don't have to pray. We don't. So they entered into this topic of tazkiyatu nafs, purifying the soul of what? Deviance, ignorance, which resulted in deviance, to the point that some of them, Ibn Qayyim mentions in his book, Ad-Dawa Ad-Dawa, the illness and the cure, he mentions about a group of people who they would make tafsir of the ayah. When Allah mentions in the Quran, Ya ayyuha al-insan, O human being, ma gharraka bi rabbika al-kareem. What deceived you of your generous Lord? Meaning this human being is about to enter into the hellfire. So Allah questions him, ma gharraka bi rabbika al-kareem. What deviated you about Allah? What deceived you about Allah? Why did you not do the good deeds that I asked you to do, I commanded you to do. And instead you were deceived, and you're going to the hellfire. And this group of people, they will say, if Allah asks me that question, look what they'll say, huh? If Allah asks me that question, I would say, oh Allah, your mercy deceives me. Does the mercy of Allah deceive someone? This is where they went into extreme when it comes to al-raja, hoping. Understand? They went to an extreme when it comes to hoping. We hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but we're not deceived. Those people are deceived. It's called ghurur. It's no longer raja. It comes out of raja, of hoping in Allah, and it goes into deviation, al-ghurur, which is being deceived by shaitan. So the Muslim who enters into this, who learns about this topic, we learn about it from the way based on knowledge. So they misunderstood al-raja in that way that I just mentioned. They misunderstood zuhud, which is being aesthetic in the dunya, not wanting the dunya. So what did they do? Instead, they didn't want the dunya. So instead of, some of them, they won't wear any clothes. Some of them, they won't provide for their family. Now, understanding that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded you to have zuhud, yes. Don't be someone who loves the dunya so much where you want all your good deeds or everything that you do is just for the dunya. Don't be that person. But also, don't go to extreme where you're now forsaking your responsibilities. But some people, they went and understood this in the wrong way. You understand? So, when it comes to those things that we need to beautify ourselves with, I'm going to mention a few, inshallah ta'ala. We'll start with three, bi'idhnillah ta'ala. And quickly, and hope, I think time will be finished by then, to be honest. A question? Huh? About? In Surah Allah has been the ultimate goal? The ayah that I mentioned, إِنَّهُمْ كَانُوا يُسَارِعُونَ فِي الْخَيْرَاتِ وَيَدْعُونَنَا رَغَبًا وَرَهَبًا وَكَانُوا لَنَا خَاشِعِينَ. Surah Al-Anbiya, about Zakariya. طيب, number one, which is what Ibn Qayyim mentions about the bird. These three things are the act of worship. All acts of worship, they built upon three things. They built upon what? Three things. Without it, the act of worship is going to be either not present or it's going to be deficient. And these are some things that we need to beautify our hearts with. We need to have this in our heart and work towards it through knowledge. Number one, love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Love of Allah. Ibn al-Qayyim said, the love of Allah is the head of this bird. It's the head of it. Meaning it's the engine. Because of it, you're moved towards doing these good deeds. And at worship is what? It is getting closer to Allah مع غاية الحب وغاية والخضوع. Having getting closer to Allah with the uppermost level of khudu, of love, an uppermost level of submission and humility in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the first thing is instilling into your heart and beautifying your heart with the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How is someone going to have the love of Allah? Allah mentions it in the Quran. وَإِذْ قَالَ مُوسَى لِقَوْمِهِ يَا قَوْمِ اذْكُرُوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ. Musa said to his people, remember the ni'mah of Allah that he gave to you. Remember the blessings that Allah gave to you. And Allah mentions in the Quran, وَذَكِّرْهُمْ بِأَيَّامِ اللَّهِ. Remind Banu Israel, remind them of the ayam of Allah. What's the ayam of Allah? The ala'ullah, the ni'mah that Allah, the blessings of Allah that he gave to the people, and also the test that Allah put the people through. When the human being remembers this, the ni'mah that Allah gave to you, Allah gave you the eyesight, Allah gave you ability, Allah gave you the ni'mah of Islam that you never asked for, that many other people, and without it a person will enter into the hellfire forever, will never enter into Jannah, and with it you'll be happy forever in Jannah. Allah gave you that ni'mah. And learning about the names and the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it places in the heart the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the love of Allah is the thing, the engine that moves this act, the heart, to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why the Prophet, that's when you get to the level where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would stand up and pray at night until حتى تتفطرت قدماه, until his feet they start swelling and they'll start cracking. Until Aisha radiallahu anha would say, Ya Rasulallah, O Messenger of Allah, why are you worshipping so much? وَقَدْ غَفَرَ اللَّهُ لَكَ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِكَ وَمَا تَأَخَّرَ. When Allah already forgave your future sins and your past sins. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَفَلَا أَكُونُ عَبْدًا شَكُورًا. Should I not be a thankful slave? That's the level of love that he has for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? So number one, love. Number two, الرَّجَاء, hoping in Allah. Because every act of worship, if you're not doing it with hope, if you do not have hope in Allah, you're not going to do the act of worship. Someone who has no hope of Allah. Allah mentions about those people in the Quran. Allah says in the Quran, وَمَنْ يَقْنَطُ مِنْ رَحْمَةِ رَبِّهِ إِلَّا الضَّالُّونَ. Who loses hope in the mercy of Allah except for the misguided people? Shaitan sometimes is going to trick you and say to you, you're too sinful. You can't. Why are you going to the masjid to pray? You're too sinful. It's a trick of Shaitan. Why? Because, and he makes you, and the scholars, they say that itself, losing hope in Allah is worse than the sin that you've done. The sin, whatever sin you've done, losing hope in Allah is worse than it. Because what Allah says, وَمَنْ يَقْنَطُ مِنْ رَحْمَةِ رَبِّهِ إِلَّا الضَّالُّونَ. Who loses hope in the mercy of his Lord except for the misguided people. And Allah says, وَمَنْ يَقُلْ إِنَّهُ لَا يَيْأَسُ مِنْ رَوْحِ اللَّهِ إِلَّا الْقَوْمُ الْكَافِرُونَ. No one loses hope in the help of Allah except for the disbelievers. So without having hope in Allah, you're not going to do any good deed, are you? طيب? And the second wing of that bird is, so that's the heart is love of Allah that moves you. That's the thing that makes you do the good deed. Then the hope in Allah that you're going to get the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And number three is the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Fear of Allah. Because the fear, know that the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is true. Yawm al-qiyamah, there's a dangerous punishment waiting for the people. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and I was going to talk about Yawm al-qiyamah, that was my original topic to be honest. Like, Yawm al-qiyamah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there's horrors waiting for the people, Yawm al-qiyamah, wal-iyadu billah. Uthman ibn Affan used to stand on the grave and he would cry and his beard become wet and he would say, Inna hadha awwalu manzilin min manazil al-akhirah. This is the first station from the stations of the akhirah. If the grave is good, then everything else is good. And if this grave is bad, then everything else is bad. Fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you have an imbalance on these two things, someone has too much hope, what's that going to do? He's going to be doing sins and he's not going to be scared. He has no hope, no fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he has imbalance of fear, he has too much fear, what's going to happen? He's not going to be doing any good deeds. He's going to say, what's the point? Like in the act, the ibadah, acts of worship is based on what? Love of Allah that moves you to do the good deed. The hope of Allah for you to do good deeds, hoping in the reward from Allah. And the fear of Allah that is making you do the good deeds so you stay away from the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These three are just some of the good deeds of the heart that a person needs to beautify their heart with. Fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, love of Allah, and ish? Hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some scholars, they mention also, sometimes there can be an imbalance which is okay. Which is at certain times, some at a time of death, someone's dying, you remind them of the good things of Allah. So they have more hope. They're dying. They have hope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Remind them of their good deeds that they used to do. Someone does a sin, then you have a little bit of an imbalance. Have a bit more fear. Because you just done a sin, be scared of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Point is, guys, this topic of cleansing the soul and cleansing the heart is a topic that we need to delve into deeply in order to rectify our hearts. So we can meet Allah with what? إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. The one who will come in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with a clean heart. We need to learn about this topic. Not only learn about it in the way of the people of Sunnah. Be careful of the people who deviated in this topic. They have extreme fear of Allah, extreme hope in Allah. Some people, they would say, I don't have to do any good deeds anymore. I reached a level where I don't have to do, they call it yaqeen. Huh? I reached a level of certainty. When Allah mentions in the Quran, وَعْبُدْ رَبَّكَ حَتَّى يَأْتِيَكَ الْيَقِينَ. Worship your Lord until certainty comes to you. What do they mean by that? Death. But what does it mean? It means death. What do they mean? They mean I reached a level where I don't have to worship Allah. They quote it in hope. This is my hope of Allah. You understand? That's the deviation, the dangerous deviation. You'll be entering in this topic of cleansing the soul, talking about hoping in Allah, and it will deviate. Talking about love of Allah, and they'll deviate. Talking about zuhud, it will deviate. Talking about fear of Allah, they'll deviate. Talking about showing off, it will deviate. Learn it from the sources of the people of Sunnah and spread it. And one of the best people that spoke about, I'll end with this, is Ibn Qayyim. Ibn Qayyim, rahimahullah, his books, they are beautiful when it comes to this topic. Especially the book, Madaruj al-Salikin, Fi Manazil al-Sa'irin. He mentions it in, that's probably one of his best books. He mentions it there, Ad-Dawa al-Dawa, the illness and the cure, which is translated in English. So I'll recommend that you guys buy that. He speaks about it there as well. Sheikh Abdul Rahman Nasr al-Sa'idi mentions it in different places as well. And those scholars of Sunnah who spoke about this topic, I really advise, guys, because there's not enough time, it needs a little series, to be honest, where we speak about each act of worship of the heart separately. But I hope that's a door. Yeah, and if you guys open a door that you guys can enter into and look into this topic, inshallah ta'ala. And I hope I've mentioned some things about it. And inshallah, I saw some pizzas going past. So I'm going to stop there. Wallahu a'lam. صلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. الحمد لله رب العالمين. بارك الله فيكم.
Just to give some quick announcements. If you want to give any donations, there's a purple box or a purple bucket just by the exit.
Not to me. It's not for me.
This is just for the
masjid.
For
the masjid.
Just for the running of the night. Pizzas will be served downstairs, or some milkshakes. Also, we're going to do some prizes as well, and we'll have a bit of a chill and open Q&A. So that will start in the next 5-6 minutes, just whilst we get set up. I don't know if you've got 5 minutes of one or two questions on the topic, and we'll set up downstairs and call everyone down, inshallah.
They have questions? I don't think they have questions. No.
Sheikh, can you just explain further? Because the hadith is clear that whoever leaves and says that is able to come to Sulu and to Jannah. So, how do you coincide that with hope?
With hope?
No, because you said that.
Yeah.
You,
so.
There other hadith that explain that.
Yeah. Whoever says La ilaha illallah will enter into Jannah. That's true. No doubt. Even the sinners, as long as they die upon La ilaha illallah. But what's the danger here? Two things. Number one, the biggest danger is for La ilaha illallah to be taken away from you at the end of your life, because of sins of the heart that a person didn't clean. And Ibn Qayyim says in his poem Nuniyah, he has a poem called Nuniyah, which is around 4,000 lines. He says in one of them, وَحْذَرْ كَمَائِنَ نَفْسِكَ اللَّاتِي مَتَى خَرَجَتْ عَلَيْكَ كُسِرْتَ كَسْرَ مُهَانِي. Be careful of those evils of your soul, that they, when they come out against you, meaning the last moments before you die, they come out against a person and they'll destroy him, a destruction of a humiliated person. They'll take away La ilaha illallah from that person. يعني 6 months before they die, they leave Islam. How many people have you seen? They're practicing and then the next day, they're deviated, they're doing other things. طيب? So the danger is, for a person to have the danger that we fear, for a person, na'am, he has La ilaha illallah, that it might be taken away from him anytime. You need to be fearful of that. But if someone dies upon La ilaha illallah, what's the second thing that they also fear? Is being in the hellfire for a period of time. Because everyone who says La ilaha illallah and dies upon as a Muslim will enter into Jannah, no doubt. And that's the belief of Ahlul Sunnah. No doubt, they'll enter into Jannah. But, wal'iyadu billah, some of the Muslims, they'll enter into the hellfire for a period of time. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, yu'ta بِأَنْعَمِ الرَّجُلِ. On the Day of Judgment, it will be brought the most blessed man, the guy who had the person who had the most ni'mah in this dunya, cars and everything, and he will be dipped into the hellfire, dipping غَمْسَه. And it will be said to him, did you see any ni'mah in your life? He'll say, I've never seen one ni'mah in my whole life. So what about a person that's a dipping in the hellfire? So what about years and years in the hellfire? And there will be the Muslims, that's the second thing that we fear. So no doubt a person has hope, yes, no doubt a person will enter into Jannah if they say La ilaha illallah and die upon La ilaha illallah. But we're scared that, who knows if we're going to die upon La ilaha illallah. And number two, who wants to be in the hellfire for even a moment? No one. For a person should be scared of those things as well. It's the answer.
So if you have La ilaha illallah, you can have so many sins, and you don't do any good deeds, but you still believe in La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah, you could enter into Jannah eventually.
So if you say you have no good deeds, that's a different thing. La ilaha illallah entails good deeds. It entails good deeds. Lakin there will be some Muslims on the Day of Judgment, their sins will be more than their good deeds. If someone has no good deeds, not a Muslim. Yeah, the scholars, they discuss if someone doesn't pray. If he doesn't pray, is he a Muslim or not? They discuss that. Someone has no good deeds, zero. La yarka' lillahi raka'. He doesn't do one raka' for the sake of Allah in his whole life. But he just said La ilaha illallah. Yeah, he's not a Muslim. Lakin someone, let's say he has some good deeds, but his sins are so much. Then that person on the Day of Judgment, Allah will either forgive him from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or Allah will enter him into the hellfire wal'iyadu billah for a period of time, and then he will enter into Jannah. No doubt.
So for someone who isn't particularly studious, and they might have a past history of sin and feeling hopeless, what are some practical steps that they can take to try and fix their heart and fix
it? Someone... The practical steps that a person can take to fix their heart would be that a person learn. You can't say, I'm not particularly studious. You have to learn. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us to learn. Learn about the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's number one. Learn about these actions of the heart that you need to clean and learn about it in the correct way. Number one, the Quran. Number two, learn, read the Quran. It cleans the heart. The Quran is a cleaner of the heart, subhanAllah. Read it again and again, day in, day out. Number three, ponder over the Quran. Allah says in the Quran, فَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنِ. Do they not ponder over the Quran? إِنَّ فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَاخْتِلَافِ اللَّيْلِ وَالنَّهَارِ لَآيَاتٍ لِأُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ. The ayat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ponder over the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All of these things that will help you ponder over, clean the heart. Learn the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Learn the deen of Allah. Read the Quran. Ponder over the ayat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran. And ponder over, think about the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inshallah, that will benefit someone to clean their heart. Allah musta'an. With that, inshallah ta'ala, we'll end it there. Barakallah. The question then? Huh? I can't hear you too much because the fan. Now just speak louder.
It's about the Bible and the Torah.
The Bible and the Torah, yeah?
Yeah. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down the Bible and the Torah, why didn't he protect those books instead of
protecting the Quran? If Allah sent down the Bible and the Torah, why didn't Allah protect those books and only protected the Quran? Because the Bible and the Torah are only for who? Banu Israel. They were only for the Banu Israel for that period of time. As for the Quran, then it's for human beings until the Day of Judgment, all of them, not just for Banu Israel, the children of Israel. So because of that, Allah Azza wa Jal left that to be there for a period of time as a test for them as well. Allah, as Allah mentions in the Quran, بِمَسْتُحْفِظُوا مِنْ كِتَابِ اللَّهِ. The book of Allah, meaning the Torah and the Injil, was given to them to protect themselves as a test and for them for a period of time. But then when the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came, he was given the final message for all of human beings. And so because of that, because of the fact that there will be no prophet after him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him the Quran that will be preserved until Yawm al-Qiyamah. Barakallahu feek. Inshallah, we'll end it there. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.